Welcome to News 18 Showsha. I am Yatamanyu, Narain, and I am with Ian Paice, the legendary drummer of the legendary band Deep Purple. And we will be discussing 50th anniversary of Machine Head, the seminal album that changed the course of rock and roll. So, you know, sir, looking back half a century, I mean, could you share some memories from the time leading up to the recording of Machine Head? And what was the atmosphere within the band like?
Well, the miracle of the record is that it was actually recorded at all. There were so many things that worked against us. We only had three weeks to record it. We had the Rolling Stones truck for 3 weeks. After that, it had to go somewhere else. And obviously, everybody knows the first recording venue was the casino, which burned down. So we lost 2 days there. We moved to another place where we actually recorded the backing track to Smoke on the Water. That was too loud. We couldn't control the sound, and the police threw us out of there. So we lost another 2 or 3 days. And eventually, our dear friend Claude Nobbs, who ran the entertainment in Montreux, he found us an old hotel which had shut for the winter. Right. And we managed to get in there. But now we only had 12, 13 days left of recording time. We had very, very limited ideas of what the songs would do, because we'd been working on the road. And they were just basic ideas. They weren't even completed arrangements. So we basically put the songs together as we recorded them.
Right.
And we listened back and they sounded okay. And we thought, we've got a record now, we'll go home. And we'll leave Ian and Roger to do the vocals and write the lyrics. But our recording engineer, Martin Burt, said, look, you can't go home. There's not enough time. The record is too short. You know, what do we do? So he said, let's listen to the backing track thing we did in the first place, you know. Could have had no title. So we listened to it and it sounded okay. Then Ian and Roger came up with the great idea of writing a lyric telling the story of making of the record.
Right.
So they went and they wrote the lyric, and it took them 10 minutes to write the lyric. And the title was Smoke on the Water, which Roger got the idea from seeing the smoke from the fire of the casino drip across the lake, floating on water. Anyway, from this little track that we didn't think much about, now it was a song, it made a lot of sense. And we sort of, we didn't think it was anything special. We thought it was a nice album track. But what it had two magic pieces in it. It had that riff, and it had the chorus that people think, Smoke on the Water. Yeah. So you put those two together, and all of a sudden, this very, very, to us, regular album track suddenly sounded a little more than we thought it was. We never thought it would be a big hit. I don't think artists ever really know that. You know, you put the songs out there, and it's up to the audience what they make of them.
Right.
But we were now signed to Warner Brothers in the US to release records, and they were trying to get airplay. And they liked this song, but it was too long. It was like 5.5 minutes long. And unbeknownst to us, one of their record execs took the masters into a studio and he edited it down to 3 minutes 15.
Right.
And said that, and then the radio station started to play it.
Right.
And one radio station followed another radio station. And in the end, every radio station's playing it. Then people realized that that song came from an album, the Machine Head album. And that's what made the Machine Head album take off. But it came down to the decision from one record company guy in Los Angeles to take 2 minutes of music out of it to basically kickstart Deep Purple's whole career again in the US. And, of course, make a very good record into something very special for a lot of people.
Interesting, sir. So, you know, the tracks in the album, they have been used countless times, you know, in TV shows, in movies, in commercials. So, I mean, what are your thoughts on how Machine Head, you know, permeated, you know, it trickled out into the popular culture around the world?
Well, I think there are certain albums from that period of time, not just Purple Records, but Zeppelin, Hendrix. You can name probably 10 different bands who had important records in their careers at that period of time, because music was, for that generation, music was everything. There was nothing else. There were no computers, no phones. You had no money. You couldn't travel. You know, music was everything.
Right.
And I think what came out of that very short period of time was incredibly important for our generation. And I think the reality of it all, the humanity of it, still translates today when kids hear it, those old records today.
Right.
They're not perfect, but they're perfect.
Perfect.
You know what I mean? They're not made to be robotic. They're human beings creating something artistic for a few minutes at a time. And that translates today.
Interesting, sir. So, I mean, how do you see this album, you know, since it is considered the greatest rock albums of all times, how do you want to, you know, Machine Head to be remembered and interpreted by, you know, future fans and future musicians?
Well, I think after this amount of time, you sort of understand that there is a magic to this record, which each generation who hear it connect with. And so long as the style of music that it represents is put in front of the public, there'll be enough of the next generation who will find something that they like in it and would hopefully maybe inspire them to play an instrument, to find out if they have that hidden talent inside them. Because most people don't look. You know, most people don't look. But if you find something you can do and you enjoy it, follow it. You know, it might be playing a guitar, it might be painting a picture, it might be dancing, doesn't matter. Follow it. But you've got to look for it. Most people don't look and they miss out on a great deal of fun in their lives.
Right, sir. I agree. So, I mean, Deep Purple has often been credited, you know, for influencing the development of heavy metal and progressive rock genres. So how do you feel about this legacy?
Well, metal is part of something we did, from the in rock time with Speed King and to Highway Star and some of the other tracks, Fireball. It was part of what Deep Purple did. The metal guys made it everything they did. Nothing wrong with that. They found something they liked and they fine-tuned it. So everything relates back to those two or three tracks from us, and a couple of Zeppelin tracks and a couple of Black Sabbath tracks.
Yeah.
It started there. But it was part of what Purple did. You know?
Right.
I don't know whether I'm proud of it or not. I find a lot of metal stuff a little difficult to deal with. But like everything, the best guys in any genre of music, they stand out. You know, and even if you don't maybe understand the music, you know that they're really good at what they do.
Right.
You know, if you take the most simple rock of all, like an AC/DC, brilliant band. Nobody else can do it like they do it. You know, so you've got to understand that it's the same, but it's different. But the good guys become very apparent very, very early. You just know that they're different. They don't even know they're different, but they are.
Right, sir. So, but sir, you know, for Deep Purple to stay at the top of the game for over 50 years is also a very momentous feat in itself. So what's the secret behind this?
I think it's very simple. I think you stay true to your own beliefs, and whenever you hit that stage, you be as good as you can.
Right.
Never let it just be another gig.
Right.
Give everything you have for that audience that night.
Right.
They will stay with you and you will enjoy your career.
Right, sir. So, you know, the world knows that Deep Purple, Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin are referred as an holy trinity of British hard rock and heavy metal. So, I mean, having said that, how has Deep Purple's equations with Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin, I mean, evolved over the years?
Well, there were three bands pursuing similar but different directions. There was Purple, there was Sabbath and Zeppelin.
Right.
Zeppelin were taking a very blues route. Sabbath were taking a much harder, even metallic route. And Purple were just exploring all the possibilities that we could do musically because we had really, really good players in the band all over. But really, if you want to go back to the origins of it, you have to look at The Who. The Who took music somewhere else. It had not gone before. They took the volume level up. They used volume as an instrument. They had the wonderful songwriting of Pete Townshend and an amazing band. And they changed music before Purple, before Zeppelin, before anybody. They took it away from little pop songs and they made it something different. And we followed on from them, you know. Very important band, The Who.
Right. So, you know, the music industry has also changed drastically. I mean, from the time when you guys started. So what are your thoughts about the current state of music industry, especially in the genres of, you know, hard rock, progressive rock and metal?
Well, I think the problem at the moment is that it's almost like gone an unfortunate full circle now.
Right.
The media is now controlling the music we hear. Instead of when we were doing it, the industry were clever enough to understand they knew nothing about what we were doing, but kids were buying it. And so they just let us get on with it. They didn't try and interfere with music. They didn't say, well, that last record was a hit, you're going to make another one that sounds like the last record. They just let us get on with it. And of course, the artists did okay, but the record companies made billions by leaving the artists in control. Now it's getting so formularized, and what kids can hear is becoming so limited. I understand the pressure on radio stations. It's about how many people listen to you, same as TV stations. But, you know, it ends up being, it narrows the horizons of what people can hear, what they see, and it becomes a little dull. You know, it's very, very hard, unless you're going to find a good old classic station, to hear any music anymore, because what you're going to get, you're just going to get hip hop and rap, which, fine, if you love it, that's fine. We all find things we like. But to me, I have really no connection with it. And I just find it boring. It's as simple as that. And it doesn't matter whether it's Backstreet Boys or Eminem. I lose interest. So here, there are no real hooks. There's no melodies. It's the same tempo. I just turn it off. I mean, so at the moment, I find what kids are being subjected to a little insulting. Kids have the same desire they've always had to find something interesting and new. But when you're not even allowed to know it exists, then I have a problem with that.
Right, sir. So, I mean, tell us something about, you know, Deep Purple's connection with India and Indian fans. And, I mean, what kind of Indian music appeals to the band?
It's very, very hard to get what you might call real authentic Indian music over here. We, you know, it's like you're trying to get authentic Indian food in England. It's not. It's English Indian food. It's different.
Right.
You know? I had the great privilege of seeing Ravi Shankar at my good friend George Harrison's house. George and Ravi were great friends, and George would have him with his band with his entourage of people over to his house to play for his friends, and that was amazing. Again, when you see the best, it's very obvious. There's that leap in class. But we don't get a lot of, although we have a big Indian expat community in Britain, we don't get a lot of possibilities to hear it. When we're over there, you can't ignore it. It's there everywhere, you know.
Everywhere.
And as a drummer, I'm totally mystified by Indian rhythms. You have time signatures like 37/5, as I am. We don't understand that, you know. And until somebody explained to me how the sounds you make with your voice can relate to rhythms, that made now it's, I can't do it, but it, at least I understand why it works now. But it is totally unique, and something that we in the West just have no cultural connection to. So we are mystified by it, absolutely mystified.
I agree, sir. So final question, one last question. I mean, Deep Purple had a vast influence on a range of artists and bands over the years. So how do you hope the band will be remembered in another 50 years?
That's a tough one. I just hope people will look back at the better things we did, because not everything you do throughout a whole career is as good as you'd want it to be. I mean, I look back at like an amazing artist like Prince. He'd make a great record, then he'd make an average record. Then he'd make a great record. Then it's almost like when he ran out of money, he'd make a great record. Then he'd make, so, you know, I think people, in 50 years' time, I hope people will find things we did that they can find a connection with, even if it's a generation that are long gone. I think some of those wonderful records that came out from that period of time do have that human connection. And I think that goes beyond the years. And I hope that is still a possibility for some of our music in the future.
Hopefully, sir. So that's it from my end. I mean, it was such an honor speaking with you, sir. Congratulations on Machine Head 50th anniversary.
Thank you very much. Lovely talking to you too.
Thank you.